Okay, now coming back to magnetics, it is a topic which probably you guys may have studied at multiple stages, right? And therefore, you may already know most of the things. So I would try to write things a little bit quickly, and then you let me know if you are if this is something new and you want me to spend more time. So magnetic field intensity represented by H. Units are ampere per meter. Magnetic flux represented by phi. Units are Weber. Magnetic flux density represented by B, units are Weber per meter square or Tesla. Just represented by T. Integral closed loop S dot dl is the total current passing through that loop. I'm sure you have been seeing this figure from ages. So there is a right hand thumb rule. What does it say? It says if your thumb points towards the flow of current, then your fingers would point towards flow of magnetic field, right? So current is going inside. So the magnetic field is pointed in this direction. So if you integrate S dot dl over a closed path, that becomes equal to summation of all the current that is flowing through that loop, right? And the other law, which is B is equal to mu H, where mu is the permeability of material, which is given by mu naught into mu R. Mu R is permeability of air, and mu R is relative permeability, right? Or space, which is given by 4 pi. So, these basic things all of you know, right? There's nothing new here. Then let's talk about the toroid and try to apply these formula there and find what is H, what is B in a toroidal. Toroidal or a toroid is something like you have a tube, right, which is circular in shape, and over the tube you have wound wires, tightly wound wires, right? I'll just rest of the circuit, I'll draw it like this. So this is a toroidal. Now toroidal can be a hollow tube, right? Or it could actually be made up of some other material. So it may have some other value of mu. Again, if you take a path in the toroidal, right, at a distance of, let's say, small r, right? And if you try to apply integral of H dot dl is equal to sigma of I, right? Then you can see that because of symmetry, you can assume H in this circle, which is inside, this is same, and therefore you can write just this thing as H into total length, which is 2 pi r. And the total current is nothing but number of turns into current I, right? And what would be the direction of H? Direction of H would be in this direction, right? So H is nothing but given by this expression. If you see this term N into I, we would also call it sometimes as MMF. Magnetomotive force, short form MMF, right? The other thing was, if we substitute now H from this second expression into the first expression, then we get B into 2 pi r. I would probably just continue to write it as L, which is the length of this total circle, upon mu is equal to N into I. I can write flux density as flux upon area N into I. This thing I can rewrite it as MMF is equal to flux into reluctance, where R reluctance is given by L upon mu A. So you guys are aware about this, right? Yes or no? Yes. What is L upon mu A? So just these three terms put together, we are calling it reluctance. So if you see, we are trying to create an analogy between the magnetic circuit and the electrical circuit, right? Electrical circuit, you have resistance, right? Which increases with length and which reduces with the cross section area. So very similar term, reluctance. In electrical circuit, you had a voltage. In magnetic circuit, you have an MMF. Voltage is equal to current into resistance. Here, MMF is equal to flux into reluctance. So flux behaves like current, right? So this is similar to or analogous to V is equal to IR equation. So essentially what does it mean is, this circuit, which is a much simpler circuit, you can see there is one MMF. So there is one source and the whole path is same and there is only one path, right? So therefore there is one reluctance. So this circuit, you can represent it as a voltage source and a resistance. This is reluctance, this is MMF, and you find what is the flux using the circuit analysis. So just by defining these terms, MMF and reluctance, we could create an analogy between electrical circuit and magnetic circuit. They would, why not? That is the whole purpose of doing it. So all the KCL, KVL, all the nodal analysis, whatever you have done, they would all can be applied. Once you have a magnetic circuit, you convert into electrical equivalent circuit. Then to solve that electrical equivalent circuit, you apply whatever tools you know of solving any other circuit, right? Sorry, say again. Yeah, reluctance would be positive. It is same as resistance. Reluctance would be L upon mu A, right? So L is positive, A is positive, mu is positive. Yes, reluctance is real. So now if you see, this circuit thing is only valid if, or the circuit analysis is only valid if circuit is linear, right? Our circuits were linear because resistance R was constant. So when we write V equal to IR, right, R is constant. If R itself is a function of I or V, then the circuit would have square terms, right? So this would no longer be linear. Same thing applies here. So in this case, you see that I've assumed mu to be constant, R, and therefore reluctance is constant. In real life, mu may not necessarily be constant, and mu may itself change with H or B, right? So if you have this BH curve, so slope of this would tell you mu, and if you start from DC and you go, it looks something like this. It means value of mu is changing, right? We can say that this is linear region. We can more or less assume mu to be constant, and then we are into saturation, where mu is drastically reducing. Mu is large first, and then mu is reducing, right? Mu is B by H. So if mu is constant, then you can use circuit theory, right? But if we don't consider mu to be constant, right, then you cannot apply that circuit theory. So if mu is assumed to be constant, implies reluctance is constant, implies linear circuit, implies use linear circuit analysis to solve. Otherwise you cannot, right? So if mu is not constant, you can still use the laws, the basic laws, which is integral of H dot dl is equal to sigma of current, right? But you cannot use conversion to electrical circuit and then solving using basic electrical laws. Here you have large mu, and then as you move towards saturation, you have small mu. So if these characteristics you would have seen, right? This is for a magnetic material. If you take air, then more or less air mu remains constant for very large value of H also, right? So air sort of does not saturate. So if you see air, its mu would be small, but then it would pretty much remain constant over a long period of time. So let's say this is air and this is some other metal or something, right? Other thing to observe here is that if you apply a DC current in this toroidal, right, then yes, your DC current would be at one of the point in this path. But if the current that you are supplying to the toroidal is AC current, right, then what happens is, this is B, this is H. What is H? H is proportional to MMF, right? Why? Integral of H dot dl is equal to N into I, which is proportional to current, right? So if you apply an AC current, then first time it goes like this, but then while coming back, it comes back like this, and then it goes like this, and then it oscillates in this path, right? If you apply an AC voltage, AC current to this toroidal or to any other material. That we'll not talk about this in great detail now, but just few things you can understand. One is that even if you have excited this toroidal with an AC current, and even if you make current zero or you make H zero, your flux does not become zero, right? So you have a remaining value of flux, which is called as residual flux. Residual flux or residual flux density, right? In this case, we are writing B. So this is residual flux density. So there is some flux density which is still remaining. Also, would, as we would prove it subsequently, is that when we do this, trace this BH curve, right? This is a hysteresis curve. So when we are going up, we take a different path. When we come down, we take a different path. So in this process, we are losing some energy, right? We would talk about it when we talk about transformers in a little bit more detail. But as of now, this is just for your idea. Most of the magnetic circuits, we would stick with DC excitation for the next one or two lectures. So the top graph is what would be applicable for some of the problems that we would do now. And later when we talk about transformers in great detail, then we focus more on this hysteresis loop. We call it hysteresis loop. Let's try to maybe apply this thing to one of the problems. Let's say you have a core of this shape. Instead of toroidal, you have a core of this shape. This core has a relative permeability of mu r, and rest is air mu naught. And you are forcing a current I into this. So using right hand thumb rule, the direction of flux or H would be going up or going down in the left limb. Going up, okay. So this is your direction of H or flux or B. Right? Let's say we take some dimension. So starting from this point and ending till this point, the total length is L, and this small length is LG. We call it air gap. Right? That is a very, very small air gap, and rest of the material is made up of relative permeability mu r and has a length of L, and the cross section is A, or the cross section area which this flux would see is A, and that is also uniform across the all material except this small air gap, which is just air gap, right? There's nothing there.
Is the cross section area perpendicular to B?
Yes, cross section area perpendicular to B, because in the definition of reluctance, if you remember what was A, A was nothing but the area, which was the toroidal cross-section area perpendicular to B. Same thing here. So now, how can I solve this circuit? If I go by the basic principle, integral H dot dl is equal to N into I, right? N is the number of turns. I can, this full material, since it is of the same cross section, right, I can assume that H remains same in this full material except the air gap. So I can say H1 into length 1, L1, plus H air gap into length air gap is equal to N into I. I can further write it as, in terms of B, B1 L1 upon mu 1 plus BG LG upon mu G. Mu G is the air gap, or let me call it just as mu naught, is equal to N into I, which I can further write in terms of flux as B1 is the flux density, which I can write it as flux 1 into L1 upon mu 1 into A, which is the cross-section area of the core. Now, what happens in the air gap? Air gap, what is flux and what is the cross-sectional area? I'm drawing a zoomed version of the top figure. So whatever flux is coming from here actually passes this surface, right, and goes to the other core, right? Flux is similar to current, right? So whatever flux is coming from the top has to go below, right? I'm still not written. Oh, sorry, BGLG by mu naught. Earlier I wrote mu g, then I thought we are just citing it air gap, so I wrote it as mu naught. Yes, L is the total length, and it is same since there is same cross section area. So therefore, I consider same L, total L. So now, if you are seeing the air gap, then whatever flux is coming from the top part of that metal would go into that bottom part, so that all the air, the flux would flow through air gap. So the flux remains the same, right? So I can say that flux 1 upon Lg upon mu naught into, I have to write something about area now, right? Because Bg is flux density, flux is the same. What about the area? It happens that if this length is very small, if air gap is very small, then usually the flux would just directly follow the minimum reluctance path and would flow like this. In that case, the cross-sectional area of the air gap is pretty close to the cross-section area of the core, and it is safe to assume that A is same. So what is this? I can take flux common. I can write L1 upon mu1 A plus Lg upon mu naught A is equal to Ni, which is nothing but flux into reluctance 1 plus reluctance air gap is equal to MMF. So I could have just directly converted this into an electrical equivalent circuit by such as this MMF. Reluctance 1, reluctance air gap, and flux. So you can, whenever you see an electrical circuit, and if it is being told that you can assume constant mu, then you can just directly convert into electrical equivalent circuit. Draw voltage source, which is MMF, draw reluctance, resistance, which is reluctance, find the current, which is flux. If it is mu is not constant, then you have to still follow the same approach. In your tutorial, you would have question where mu would not be constant, and so you would get a feel of how to solve those questions also. There is one more change. So as I told you that flux would try to follow minimum reluctance path. So it would just flow parallel, right? So it would have the same cross section, but that is not precisely true. So some of the flux would also take this little bit longer path. So therefore we call it as maybe some kind of fringing. And because of that, the cross-sectional area of the air gap may be 5 to 10% more than area of the core. Right, and therefore it tries to expand out, but then if it expands out too much, the L becomes more for the effective length of that path, right? No. If you imagine that flux is going like this, so its length becomes more. So it would not expand to too much, but it will expand a little bit. So usually in questions, if nothing is given, then it is safe to assume that AG is equal to A. If we would like you to consider this effect, then we would give you the value of this fringing in terms of percentage, 5, 10, 2, 3, 4, something like that, right? Yes, we just need to modify AG. So still you can use the same approach. You calculate R1 as L1 upon mu 1A. You calculate RG as LG upon mu 0 into AG. That's it. So you still can use the same approach. Next class, we'll talk about one core and two coils. As of now, we have only talked about one core with one coil. So there was only one MMF, right? Now, if you have two coils, you have two MMF in the circuit. So the challenge would be whether the MMF would be positive or would it be negative. Do you understand? If I have this as the core and now I put two coils, one on this side, one on this side. Now I want to convert this into electrical equivalent. So I would have a voltage source of N1I1, reluctance of this limb also, reluctance of this limb. And now should I have source connected like this or should I have source connected like this, whose magnitude I know is N2I2, right? So this is something which we would look in next class.